Lord of Fury, on our glorious Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher.
Hello, everybody. There in Ireland, and there in England, and there in Wales, and there in Scotland, I would like to say to you, do you think we should stay a member of the common market? You will find that out in...
See you next week. Say what? Why? Something like it. Moments of Stone Age. Of stone. Oh, to live in these islands with the people of the old Stone Age. They have left us no books, no writings, but their story is written in monuments of stone.
But through the periods of great cold, the ice ages followed by years when the weather was much warmer than it is today, there were only a few of them who faced the belly dangers of the strange, quiet world.
Their life was a hard one. The cold winters drove them to seek homes in caves or pits. Through the summer, light shadows of bright weaver camps of skin placed over holes in the ground.
Their life was a hard one. The cold winters drove them. There has been a bomb square on the Queen's Bridge. For the bomb square on the Queen's
Bridge. President Kennedy has been assassinated. And wherever we go, the people are looking for the assassin.
Was between 1 a.m. and 2 c. The 1 a.m. team were W. McCauley, D. Manna, J. Tinsley, B. Gibson, S. Phillips, and the substitute was D. McCready. C team were K. Rankin, T. Reed, J. Montgomery, R. Colbert, W. Campbell, and the substitute was P. Kell.
Staff from the Somerdale Film Society. It shows some of the varied activities of our large modern secondary school, in class and out of class. But time permits only a brief glimpse at most activities. The object of the film is to give a first impression of Somerdale to primary
84, Mexico on the ball. Somebody else pushing up now. Blue ball on the ball. Pushes to Hugh Sinclair. A good ball from Hugh down to Raymond again in the far corner. And it's a quick to Mexicans. Lennon Larson on the ball. Tries out an ambitious ball, cut off. Raymond Barr trying to get in. Good tackle from Joe. Thank you.
Unfortunately, bad historians will only present a partial opinion. They will present it from one particular point of view only. And that, I'm afraid, is not good history.
I think perhaps I should come in at this point. Mr. Maguire's introduced a very interesting idea, the idea of propaganda. Putting out of information which is not really meant to inform people, but to very deliberately shape people's opinions. In fact, both sides used propaganda at the time of the wars in Ireland. For example, William actually brought a printing press to England with him, and he printed pictures and circulated them as propaganda. People at the time, you see, although they couldn't read, many of them, were very good at picking out all those little symbols in the pictures, ones that we've forgotten or would hardly notice now. The background to these prints is that on the 30th of June in 1690, William was injured by a cannonball. It was aimed at his party by a group of Jacobite gunners. He wasn't killed, but his so-called death was actually reported back in Paris. And the French produced that propaganda print, which celebrated his death.
If you look very closely at the first picture, you'll notice that the corpse bearers represent William's leaders.
And also something else which is interesting. We have the Princess of Orange here, and following her we've got several characters which stand for the countries which supported William. We have Holland, Scotland, the traitors of England, and the Irish.
On the right-hand side of the picture, William is there, and he seems to be descending into hell, and Schomburg seems to be already there.
The second print was produced by the Dutch. They've made changes to the original, removing the French propaganda images, and they've created a new message.
On the second picture, the names are missing from over the heads of the torchbearers.
And they've removed William's descent into hell.
The caption says it all, actually. Folie extravagante de la France, foolishness of France, sur la mort imaginaire de Guillaume III, on the imaginary death of William III.
Clearly it mocks the celebration of William's death, a death that did not occur.
It reminds me of Mark Twain's remarks that reports of his death were greatly exaggerated.
What were the long-term outcomes of the war in Ireland?
Well, Protestants went on distrusting their Catholic neighbours. Mind you, that happened in other parts of Europe for a long time. And different countries later found different ways to resolve the problem or become united by a common feeling of nationality. In Ireland, people remained separated by religion and nationality.
What about the Irish Parliament? What happened to it?
This short piece of film may help. Irish MPs went to Parliament at Westminster, and they tried over the years to change the law so they could run their own affairs. But the Protestant Irish MPs were afraid they would suffer as a minority in Ireland, and they supported the Act of Union with Britain. That's how they got the name Unionists. An association was formed in 1795 by Protestants who are dedicated to the memory of William III and his ideals of democracy with freedom of religion for all. And they called it the Orange Order after William's title and state. In the end, one side fought to break away from the rest of Britain, while others in Ireland fought to remain. And the result was the dividing of the country in 1922.
But wasn't that a common outcome of the Battle of the Boyne for both sides in Ireland?
Let's ask the historian.
Yes, I think there was. You'll notice that in England, and indeed in Ireland in the 18th century, Parliament became more and more important than monarchy. And this continued right through into the 20th century. In the 19th and early 20th centuries, Irish MPs sat at Westminster. But when the Irish Free State was founded in 1922, you will notice with interest that the Westminster model was used, the system of parliamentary government was used. So in that sense, you could trace perhaps an influence going right back to William of Orange and to the events of the 1690s.
So in that way, both parts of Ireland did inherit one part of William's legacy?
What do you think?
Remember, when you work on using source material, wherever it is available, take care to assess it carefully for bias and tried to separate the fiction from the facts.